All right, let's get rolling. So welcome to the podcast, bro.
Thank you.
Appreciate you coming out on short notice. My guest today, guys, Juan Montes from The Tax Problem right here, plugging the business. I guess to start off, I met you through another colleague of mine. He kind of told me about what you do and how you help people with their tax debt and all that stuff. And I saw you speak at one of our events, and I just thought you were really just offering some genuine advice. And I thought, man, it'd be a good segment to bring you on, because there's a lot of entrepreneurs who are going through tax issues, right? Mm-hmm. So I guess start off by maybe just introducing yourself and, you know, tell me about who Juan Montes is, how you got into this career.
Thanks for having me, first of all. Yeah. And, you know, I got into this kind of, like you said, you know, offering genuine advice. Mm-hmm. I got into this because while I was in college at San Jose State, you know, I went home after a class to take a look at my parents' tax returns, and they were screwing them up. The person who was preparing them.
Yeah.
So, you know, at that point, I started researching what it would take to actually learn how to do this, do it right. And like everything else, it started with friends and family. Mm-hmm. It spread to friends telling friends. And next thing I know, it you know, I have a client list. And so, yeah, just snowballed from there. You know, finished my degree at San Jose State in accounting. Then I got my law degree and my enrolled agent license, and now all I do is defend people and beat the IRS.
Beat the IRS, right? You told me earlier that your license plate, what did your license plate say?
My car's license plate, K-O-I-R-S. So knockout IRS.
I think that's awesome, man. Just it's funny, it's catchy, and even from a marketing perspective, right? You're driving around and people are like, what is that, right?
Yeah.
The other thing I thought was cool was just the name of your company or your website, The Tax Problem, right? It's just, to me, that just immediately caught my eye. Like, all right, let's see what this guy's all about. Like, yeah. what can you do with the tax problem, so to say? So I guess, how long have you been doing this for?
So I've been in the tax work, doing tax work for 14 years now. Started in 2005. Mm-hmm. And then my focus exclusively on fixing tax problems started in 2014.
Wow.
So that's been just over 5 years now.
Over 5 years. Yeah. So are you working on people's like tax returns and all that stuff too? Or are you mostly just defending like tax debt and stuff like that?
Good question. So a lot of people who have tax issues haven't filed in a while.
Oh, okay.
So I have to keep that part of the practice alive. I don't prepare a lot of tax returns on that front. I don't market for that. Mm-hmm. But I, you know, my clients do refer others, and if we're a fit, we work together.
Got it.
You know, it has to be as much a fit for them as it is for me, mm-hmm. just to make sure that we're both happy.
Yeah.
But, you know, I defend a ton of audits and help people settle tax debts and all of that. And to do that, you have to really understand the ins and outs of not only what the law says, mm-hmm. but how the IRS actually interprets that mm-hmm. and looks at it.
Yeah.
So that also helps me when I'm preparing a return. I have the perspective of actually knowing what the IRS is going to think about this down the road should they question it.
Got it.
Because, you know, audits are so rare. They audit 0.6% of tax returns, which is next to nothing.
Wow.
So the majority of people preparing returns actually have never defended an audit.
Wow.
And not to say they're not good.
You know what's funny, though, is my first year in business, I got audited. My first year. I didn't even make that much money. I didn't even know what the heck I was doing, right? And so maybe I was lucky. I don't know.
Might have been lucky. Yeah.
Just played a lot of.
Yeah, might have been a red flag. You know, this week I spoke to a client, asked him what his income is. He tells me, and then he sends me a copy of his return because I'm going to help settle some tax debt. I look at the return, and he has a huge number of income on the income line, but then on another line there's a big fat negative number, which shouldn't be there. And immediately I'm like, look, I don't know what your tax professional is doing, but one of two things is happening. They either really don't know what they're doing, or they're purposely doing something that's going to get you in a lot of trouble. Mm-hmm. So you're really lucky you haven't been audited yet, and we need to fix this ASAP, but you need to go back and correct all of this.
Yeah, so. It's just a red flag, right?
Major red flags, yeah.
Got it. And while we're on the topic of audits, do they randomly pick people for audit, or are they going after like the bigger fish, people making more income where they can probably, you know, get more of that tax debt back, right?
Yeah, so very good question, and it's a two-part answer. Mm-hmm. I'll start with the one that I don't like, which is, you know, you asked if they're auditing the big dollar ones.
Yeah, yeah.
The IRS actually flat out has said they're focusing on the little people.
Oh,
So they're hurting the ones that are actually harmed after an audit.
Yeah.
And they know there's much more money to be had by auditing the higher income individuals, but those people also hire a lot of people to really defend them, and the IRS would rather pick on people who maybe won't defend themselves.
Wow.
So I'll leave that there, and that's why we need to KO the IRS, right?
The
other thing for reasons for audit, you know, the primary reason is just random selection.
Yeah.
You know, just gets picked out of a hat, and then it gets reviewed by an auditor, and if they feel like, yeah, we should review this, then you'll get it something in the mail.
Yeah.
And then, you know, they never take a phone call from them because probably a scam. So wait for something in the mail. Mm. It'll tell you what they want to see, whether mail it in or show up. But I recommend you talk to your tax professional. If they can't help you, call someone who can, because even when you're right, they'd like to say you're wrong. But that's
the story. So those guys calling me like from this 1-800 number saying I'm going to go to jail and all this stuff and I better send them some money, that's a scam?
100%, yeah. Send me iTunes.
All the time, bro.
Yeah, send me iTunes gift card numbers, right?
Yeah,
100% scam.
Yeah.
Another major reason is every time, especially for businesses, every business has to put their business code on the tax return, meaning what kind of business it is.
Got it.
And the IRS has something called a DIF score, D-I-F. And what they do is, for example, for realtors, they receive X number of millions of returns from realtors across the country.
Yeah.
So they know about how much a realtor's spending on marketing, on MLS fees, on vehicle expenses, you know, whatever the expenses are. And then they create what are called standard deviations and averages and things like that. And when they see something really outside an outlier that's really outside of the norm, that'll trigger them to select the return for review. Doesn't mean it's an audit yet, but somebody will physically look at it and then decide, do we need to audit this individual?
Got it.
And then a third way they audit is if somebody reports that somebody's doing something they shouldn't be doing. You know, they're cheating on their taxes or
so someone can call in and just say, hey, this guy's doing fraud, or you better audit him.
It's not that simple, but you know, an angry ex-wife, an angry business partner, an angry former business partner, you know, somebody you upset, things like that. So, and then another way is if your tax preparer has been caught doing something they shouldn't be doing, they'll go through and they'll audit the people whose returns he's prepared or she's prepared to then, you know,
well, that makes sense, right? Because if they were doing something kinky, maybe they're doing something for their clients too.
Yeah.
So it pays off to be a good person and follow the rules, right? So
absolutely.
Someone calls the IRS on you, right?
Yeah, and it pays off to work with somebody who's following the rules.
Yeah.
Because if you're working with a tax pro who's just doing things they shouldn't be doing, you're going to be in hot water.
Is there a way to find out, like, do they have like a record, or can you look them up and see if they've ever had like any complaints or anything like that?
Good question. So in California, there's four people who can prepare tax returns. Attorneys, and if they do returns and that's who you're working with, you can look them up at the state bar.
Got it.
And on the state bar's website, and you can see their history of whether there are any issues. CPAs, you can look at the Board of Accountancy and see whether they've had any issues. Mm. Enrolled agents, you can look it up with IRS.
Yeah.
And then there's people who are, they're called CTEC registered. You can go to the CTEC website and then see if there are any issues there and make sure their license is active as well.
Got it. So now those different titles, which one are you?
I'm an enrolled agent.
Enrolled agent. Yeah. So what's the difference between, I mean, I know what an attorney is, but the other ones?
So a CPA is licensed by the state of California. Right. Enrolled agents are licensed by the federal government.
I'm
licensed by the U.S. Treasury. And from a practical perspective on what we do on a day-to-day, probably more than 95% of things overlap.
Mm-hmm.
One thing that an enrolled agent cannot do that a CPA can do is, for example, audit your company's financials and then sign off that they're 100% legitimate because they've audited and they know that there's a high level of confidence that there's no fraud or nothing bogus on there, right?
Got it.
That type of work is restricted for CPAs.
CPA.
But other than that, pretty much everything else is the same.
Wow. So is a CPA, if they're signing off on that, are they kind of creating some liability for themselves?
Absolutely. So typically, you know, Wall Street relies on these reports because the SEC requires it. If it's a small business, what ends up happening is maybe the business is going to be sold and the buyer wants this audit to ensure that they're, you know, the numbers they're being given are real.
Oh, I see.
And then and CPA comes in, does the audit, says, yeah, these numbers are accurate. And if later they turn out to not be accurate, that CPA certainly could be on the hook for something.
Yeah, because they caused some damages there.
Yeah.
Okay, cool, man. So jumping ahead, you know, following back up to the tax problem, right? Is that the name of your company or their website or?
Yeah, that's the name of the company and the website.
Yeah.
And it just happened late night in a hotel room. So, so I was at a convention in San Diego.
Yeah.
And I'm like, yeah, I need a good name, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And then, you know, I'd been reading a whole bunch of books on marketing and, you know, it has to be catchy.
Yeah, yeah.
But it has to be short enough as well. And then, you know, your email should match and, mm-hmm. you know, all the branding stuff. So I just went on GoDaddy, mm-hmm. started looking up URLs related to tax problems, all of that. And I can't believe that URL was available. I mean, it's really, really tough to find URLs related to tax that aren't taken.
Because people even buy them just ahead of time, right?
Yeah, yeah, they buy them. And I was surprised that it was available. I mean, my name, if I wanted to go buy my name, it's on sale right now for $10,000. So I haven't been able to buy it.
Yeah, yeah.
But this thing was available and I snatched it up.
That's cool, man.
And the rest is history.
Yeah, I think you hit it there because it's catchy and it stands out to me. And it's like, it's when I can tell people, talk to my guy at the tax problem, man. Like, they're like, all right. Kind of just, it clicks. So
funny story. I had a billboard running for a few months off the side of the freeway, the electronic ones, the ones that like blinks and then it changes.
Yeah, yeah. Uh-huh.
And literally all it said was thetaxproblem.com. And then it had a phone number, right? Nothing else. Just made sure everything was really big so that people wouldn't miss it. You know, same color, same everything.
Yeah.
Then I'd go off and do direct mail to the post office, walk in there with a couple thousand letters. And then on my car, I had the big logo too and all this stuff, right? So one day I'm walking into the post office and the guy who helped me, he says, oh, you work for the tax problem? I'm like, oh yeah, you know, I'm in shorts and a t-shirt and a hat.
Yeah, yeah.
And then he's asking me more questions as he's taking all these letters off my hands. And then he asked something where I said, oh yeah, no, it's my business. He says, you're the tax problem guy? I said, yeah. He's like, I've seen your car. I've seen your billboards. I've seen your hats.
Yeah, that's awesome.
And then he's telling the other employees, hey, guys, look, come here. This is the tax problem guy.
That's cool, man. That means it's working, bro.
Yeah, it's working.
Good stuff, man. So I want to, let's talk about the actual tax problem, right? Me being in real estate, I'll share a little story. Back, you know, in the crash of the 2006, 7, 8, went from a point in my career when I was making a ton of money and, you know, you're thinking the money's never going to stop. And then all of a sudden the market crashes, right? And now it's like expenses are adding up and you got money put away for taxes, but it's like, hey, the money's not coming in. So you either got to do what you got to do. So, my story personally, I ended up, you know, falling behind on some of my taxes and these are now back taxes from like 2006 through 2008. So now later down the line, trying to refinance and stuff, it's like now the IRS is putting liens against you and all these things. So that's even why I called you the other day, just to get some of your advice. So just like me, I'm sure there's a lot of people who either the economy or whatever got into some tax problems. What do you see a lot of times? Like why are people getting into tax debt?
Good. Very good question. So I'll say a lot of the people I've helped over the last 5 years,
mm-hmm.
have been because of the recession, right? They were self-employed, a lot of realtors, mortgage lenders, construction companies, stores. What happened is exactly that. You know, funds started to dry up, but the bills didn't stop.
Mm-hmm.
And they had to take what they set aside for taxes and use it just to get by, right?
Yeah.
And there are also some great success stories. There's a realtor who, she owed over $350,000 because of all of this.
Yeah.
And I settled her debt with the IRS for $1,200.
Damn.
So she paid, out of 350 grand, she paid 1291 or 1200 something.
Wow.
So one of the things that I'll say, you know, if someone is having a tax issue, is talk to somebody sooner rather than later.
Mm-hmm.
Because I've run into a lot of people as well where they'll come talk to me when they feel they can afford me.
Mm-hmm.
But by that point, their situation's improved enough that mm-hmm. they don't qualify for a settlement anymore.
Yeah.
So they kind of shot themselves in the foot.
Yeah.
Where if they'd come 1 year before, I could have wiped out all of it for next to nothing.
Yeah.
And of course, they would have had to pay my fee, but they get rid of $100,000, $200,000, $300,000 in debt,
yeah.
which now they have to repay.
Yeah.
And And it's happened too, where people come talk to me, they qualify, for whatever reason, they're not in a point in their life where they're ready to move forward. And then they'll call me a year later, hey, I'm ready to hire you now.
Yeah.
So, okay, let's meet. We need to go over your financials. And now they're making too much money.
Yeah.
And it's heartbreaking to tell them, like, you know, this $200,000 you owe, you would have paid less than $1,000, but now you have to pay the whole thing.
Yeah.
And
I think that what you were telling me on the phone last time we chatted is that the IRS is looking at your ability to repay, right?
Correct.
So shed some light on that.
Yeah. So in that you're doing a better job than I am here.
Oh, yeah.
So don't take my job.
I was listening, bro. I was like,
So what I meant by they no longer qualify and things that is the IRS will look at two big things.
Mm-hmm.
They're not so much interested in what got you in the hot problem.
Yeah.
They're more interested in what can we get from you today?
Yeah.
Right. And what that looks like is two part analysis. The first one is, what does your income and expenses look like?
Mm-hmm.
And then they'll see a number on a monthly basis or annual basis. The second thing they look at is, what are all your assets? You know, when we use the word equity, everybody thinks of housing, but technically there's equity in everything, right? If I have a $30,000 car that's paid off, I have $30,000 in equity.
Mm.
If I have a $10,000 painting, I have $10,000 in equity in the painting.
Got it.
They'll look at all of your assets and determine what the equity is. And there's a whole bunch of rules and laws around how to calculate those things. So it's not, you know, just a straightforward calculation either. I've had a client in Patterson where he owed on his house was worth roughly $360,000.
Mm-hmm.
He owed on it, if I remember correctly, about $280,000-ish.
Mm-hmm.
So he had about $80,000 in equity in the real world.
Yeah.
But when we applied the calculations on how you calculate equity, his equity was zero.
Got it.
So we were able to get him a settlement, get the debt to go away, and he still has his house with over $80,000 in equity.
Wow.
So they look at what you own and what it's valued at, you know, 401ks, any investment accounts, any other retirement accounts. Cryptocurrency is huge right now. Tons of people have invested in Bitcoin, Ethereum, you know, Bitcoin Cash, all these other cryptos. They're looking at all of those accounts as well. They're looking at vehicles, boats, motorcycles, anything they can identify.
Yeah.
And they want to know what the value of these things are.
Yeah.
They come up with a number. Each thing has its own calculation. Then we look at, like I said, income and expenses, how much is left each month after all those expenses.
Yeah.
There's a formula there. So then after you combine these two things, that's how we arrive at the settlement.
Got it.
You know, I'll tell you, a lot of people, I'm offering a dollar. Yeah. I'm literally putting an offer amount, $1. And then I'll let the IRS, you know, say it should be something higher. We go back and forth. But I've settled a whole bunch where I don't even tell the client, you know, I don't even give them the instructions to mail in a check because it takes me too long to explain.
Yeah.
I just mail the dollar myself and get that thing paid off and we're done.
Man, that's awesome, man. So that's part of the strategy, right? You're starting low and then see what the IRS comes back with, right? Because if you offer too much and they're like, all right, and they would have settled for less, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you overpaid them.
Yeah. And then the other thing is too, is just really understanding the ins and outs of the way this all works.
Yeah.
So let me give you an example. There are a whole bunch of rules about what's allowed and what isn't allowed as an expense.
Yeah.
So let me give you an example of another client I worked with. They had roughly $1,000 in extra income after paying for all their expenses every month.
Yeah.
So the IRS would have wanted roughly $100,000 as a settlement, which, you know, they don't have $100,000 sitting around, or they wouldn't be in this problem to begin with.
Yeah.
So what we ended up doing is the rules allow you, for example, you're married, right? Mm-hmm. They allow you to have a car where you're spending up to $508 a month. Your wife can have a car where she's spending up to $508 a month. That's $1,016 a month.
Yeah.
In this case, the client, husband and wife, didn't have a car payment.
Mm.
So they actually went out, they bought new cars, and now they qualified to pay the IRS nothing.
Wow.
So the other thing is you want to work with somebody who understands the ins and outs of all these rules. You make the right moves, then you submit the offer and you can qualify.
Yeah. So just knowing how to navigate those, you can use it to your advantage, right?
Right. Yeah. And the key is don't lie, right? Like if you're strategic and you're using the rules, that's okay. What's not okay is not disclosing things or lying or something that will get you in hot water, because all of these settlements and documents, we're going to sign them and tell them that we're being truthful and we're disclosing everything. But like in this situation, you know, the IRS understands people need to be able to have, you know, reliable transportation.
Yeah.
So they'll allow you to have that monthly expense of that car.
Got it. Got it. So what do you, like the people you see on the TV and the radio and all this stuff, I mean, they're obviously always promoting like the best case scenarios and everything. Mm-hmm. But you told me like, 5-minute conversation over the phone, you're like, yeah, you're not going to qualify for that, right?
Yeah.
And meanwhile, you're saying they might take your money and like charge you just to tell you later on that you're not going to qualify. I mean, shed some light. Like, what do you need to look out for, or if you decide to like try to call one of those companies or anything?
So I'll say this. You know, these large companies, there are good ones, but they're also really bad ones. I would say the number one thing for you to look out for if you're going to call one of them is make sure whoever you're speaking to is either an attorney, get their name and their license number, CPA or enrolled agent, get their name and their license number, ask for it. Because legally, these are the only three people that can help you with this kind of problem.
Yeah.
Anybody else who doesn't have one of these three licenses, legally cannot do this work. A lot of these big companies, the people you initially talk to on the phone, they're just salespeople. And they're there because they're really good at getting you to sign on the dotted line and mail in a check or pay online. Yeah. So if you're talking to a salesperson, that's number one red flag, you run, because they can't tell you what you need to know anyway.
Yeah.
They don't know the ins and outs. They're not the ones doing the work.
Yeah.
Right. So you want to make sure whoever you're talking to is the person doing the work.
Got it. Number two,
and this happens with a lot of big businesses, but the larger the company, the more people that will touch your file. You know, that maybe isn't always a bad thing, but at the same time, I've won a lot of cases just because when the IRS asked me something, I was intimately familiar with the client's circumstances, so I could answer everything accurately and truthfully, and I knew, you know, I ask a lot of questions. There's an in-depth interview.
Yeah.
So I'm able to, I have all that knowledge because I'm the only one working your case.
Yeah.
Whereas in a larger company, somebody, an admin maybe writes this letter, somebody else does another piece of it. So no one person has the combined knowledge of your situation.
The stuff could slip through the cracks or get lost right in the shuffle.
Yeah, and then the other thing is you know, if you could work with somebody locally, that's recommended just because you know where to find them. You know where to go shake their hand and say hello. I don't think people want to do anything nefarious in their own community, right? Because even a large city like San Jose, it's a small world, you know, everybody knows everybody. So if you're not being honest, word's going to get around very quickly.
Yeah.
And those are some of the big things. And, you know, to the point of dishonesty, I talked to a gentleman maybe about a year ago. He called kind of like you and I spoke. And he had already hired one of these big companies and he'd paid them $11,000.
Wow.
And the way he described it to me is he told them, you know, what his income was and he qualified from an income perspective, perfect candidate. But he had just over $100,000 sitting in a bank account. And the company told him he qualified.
Yeah.
They submitted an offer offering $5,000 to the IRS to settle a debt of over $100,000.
Yeah.
But that, I mean, if what he told me was true, which, you know, why would he be wasting his time calling me for a second opinion at this point? They flat out lied to him, because if you have $100,000 sitting in an account, that's going to be the settlement amount the IRS is going to want.
Yeah.
You know? So if you owe $1 million, that's a killer deal.
Yeah.
But if you owe 130 and they want 100, that's not really that great of a deal.
Yeah.
You're still saving 30, I guess, but it's not as nice as saving 900,000, right?
Yeah.
But in his case, they submitted an offer that in no way was going to be accepted.
Yeah.
They charged him $11,000 for something that a newbie could have known was not going to fly. So that was just dishonest, right?
Wow. And it's tough because when you're in these situations where you owe the IRS and they're sending you letters and all this stuff, I mean, you're nervous, right? Mm-hmm. Like, you're like, you can't sleep. You're like, you just want to get this stuff cleared, you know? Mm-hmm. And I can see how people can fall for these, you know, scams, or they maybe think like, oh, this person's going to help me. He's going to bail me out. And of course, the salespeople make it sound really good. Mm-hmm. And then next thing you know, your money's gone. Right?
Yeah. No, that's a great point. I mean, people want relief. You know, they're scared, especially if the IRS went in and took money out of your bank account or they started garnishing your paycheck, or they put a lien on you, which now affects your property. And people want good news. You know, when we're in distress, we want to hear what we want to hear. Mm-hmm. You know, we're not, sometimes we don't want reality, right?
Yeah.
But that's, you know, that's how I operate. I always want good information, even if I don't like it.
Yeah.
Because that's the only way I can make a good decision.
Yeah.
And, you know, with the internet nowadays, if someone's unhappy, they're going to let the world know about it. So, you know, look up the person that you're working with or the company and see mm-hmm. what those reviews are. And, you know, the great reviews, you know, that's awesome, especially if there are a lot. You know, I'm not real good about telling my clients to give me reviews.
Yeah.
Just because I feel it's something highly personal. And,
yeah.
you know, I don't know that I'd want to go out there and say, hey, this person saved me 200 grand because yeah. I had fallen behind. And it's a tough thing. It's an emotional problem, you know, mm-hmm. because we all want to do the best we can, right?
Yeah.
But at the same time, there are over 20 million people currently who've got some sort of a tax issue. So that's a huge amount of people, right?
Yeah.
So it's also, you know, there's nothing to be ashamed of because
yeah.
it's a common problem. You know, hard times come and go, and it's just a matter of working through it.
And you were saying, like, earlier before we started, you know, recording, startup companies, a lot of these people who, you know, get into something and it doesn't work out, mm-hmm. and then they're left with all this tax liability, mm-hmm. right? Like, there's a lot of people who are in this, mm-hmm. so I guess the story is you're not alone, right?
No, and you know, a lot of times, too, it's people, you know, I've talked to prominent doctors this week.
Yeah.
I talked to a gentleman who builds police cars, right?
Yeah.
He started a company. What they do is they get the almost a shell from Ford.
Yeah.
And then they're the ones who install the lights and the, you know, all the police stuff. Everything that makes it look like a police car.
Yeah.
And then, you know, it's not City of San Jose, but San Jose PD or whoever would end up buying the car from and using it. So this gentleman went into business, didn't know what they were doing, hadn't filed returns in a number of years, and now they have this pretty big debt.
Yeah.
And like you said, it's just the lack of knowledge, lack of information. So reach out, you know, protect your business, because the last thing you want is build it, make it successful, but then be in a hole at the same time that you might not be able to get out of.
Yeah. And if you got these, you know, these debts, you know, looming over you, you can't really operate, you know, like if that's in the back of your mind, you know what I mean? It does kind of hit your ego and your confidence and all of that stuff, right?
Yeah. And it's tough. You know, let me give you another example. You know, sometimes bailing people out isn't getting rid of the debt itself, mm-hmm. but helping them manage the month to month. Let me give you an example. An individual making roughly $500,000 a year, mm-hmm. so making good money, mm-hmm. the IRS wanted them to pay $17,500 a month.
Yeah.
And that would have consumed a little more or about half of their income after taxes.
Yeah.
And it would have left them really tight, you know, based on the lifestyle they were living. Mm-hmm. They ended up hiring me, and I was able to get them a payment plan for $5,500.
Wow.
Right. Still a lot of money.
Yeah.
But they're saving $12,000 a month that they're keeping in their pocket. And they're, you know, they had to make some lifestyle adjustments, but not anything as drastic as if they had to hand over $17,500
a month.
Yeah,
that's a lot of money, man. More money, more problems.
Or another example, a restaurant, they owe over $600,000 to California Department of Tax and Fee Administration for sales taxes. Sales tax department wanted them to close the restaurant.
Yeah.
And wanted them to sell the building because they owned the building to pay off the tax debt. Their accountant had been working with them and they weren't getting anywhere. By the way, about 90% of my work is referred by other tax pros and accountants. His tax pro reaches out to me, says, hey, tells me the situation. Can you help? I said, I think so. Let me talk to the client. Long story short, it took about 7 months, but I was able to get the state board to go away. Mm-hmm. He didn't close his business. He didn't sell his building. Oh, and then they wanted him to pay $38,000 a month if he wanted to stay open. Right? That was before he hired me.
Yeah.
So it's either close the business, sell the building and pay us, or pay us $38,000 a month, which is impossible because he's making nowhere near that. Once they hired me, we settled on a $2,500 monthly payment.
Yeah.
So he's, you know, still a lot of money.
Yeah.
But $2,500 is manageable, yeah. And he has his business and he has his building.
All right, so switching gears real quick, we briefly talked about early, before we started recording, about kind of the whole profit first model, right? Like, mm-hmm. We talked about the tax problem, right? How people got into it, you know, what we're able to do to negotiate, but how do we create those good habits, you know, from the beginning, right? If you're an entrepreneur or you're just starting a business or whatever, so that you don't end up in this problem, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like, shed some light on what you recommend. I know Profit First, that's a book. I think the guy's Michael Gerber or something. That was a game changer for me, but there's similar ways, you know, to do that. But what can you tell our listeners about that?
So you're most likely already working with a tax professional. So you want to set up a meeting and you want to ask them, you know, what do I need to do now that I'm in business for myself? Mm-hmm. I think what surprises people the most is everyone's aware of what the federal tax rates are, the tax brackets.
Yeah.
But they forget that when you work for yourself, there's a whole nother 15.3% in Social Security and Medicare. Right?
Yeah.
So if you're in the 24% tax bracket, okay, I can manage 24%.
Yeah.
But then you add 15, now you're 39%.
Wow.
Right? And then you add California and you could be well over 40%.
Wow.
So at the end of the day, it's understanding roughly where you will fall so that, as you were saying, how you have a separate account for operating and then one just for tax. Mm-hmm. I have clients and I pretty much know their habits.
Yeah, yeah.
So the ones that I know are really good at, you know, they're not going to overspend. You know, they have one account, no problem. The ones where they want to make sure they're not going to dip into the tax money, they've created a separate account. And every time they have, you know, every month, they'll put an X number of dollars into that account.
Yeah.
X number of dollars into that account. Come tax time, all of them, even though there's a tax bill to be paid, they're usually really happy because there's more than enough there,
yeah,
to pay off the bill. So the key is understand your numbers,
yeah,
because you need to know what your profit is as you go. Mm-hmm. So the top line is not the important number. It's what's the profit,
yeah,
because that's what you're going to pay tax on.
Yeah.
Understand that number as you go. Make those estimated payments so you don't pay penalties.
Yeah.
Because that's another thing. If you wait until filing your return to, yeah, pay the whole bill,
yeah,
you're going to pay something called underpayment penalties, mm-hmm, which are a percentage of the balance due. So it could be a few $100. And I've seen them as high as $10,000.
Yeah.
You know, why throw away that kind of money?
Yeah.
Make those estimated payments. But the key is, if you don't know how to figure that part out, make sure you have a meeting with your tax person,
yeah,
and they'll walk you through how to put together that rough calculation.
Yeah, that was a game changer for me. We started that a couple years ago where we set up multiple accounts, mm-hmm, right? Because I think what most people do, especially, let's say like an agent who just got in the business, they have their one bank account. All their commissions are going in there, right? Mm-hmm. So they see this big giant amount and they're thinking, oh, I got a nice little chunk of money right here. But they're forgetting that X percentage belongs to the IRS, right? Mm-hmm. So just by simply creating additional accounts where you're kind of putting that money in there and like you don't see it, right? Mm-hmm. Now you're only really seeing what you got left. And then in your mind, you're going to spend based off of that.
Yeah. Right? Yeah, it's like creating a budget,
yeah,
and then having an account for the major categories in that budget,
yeah,
to make sure that there's always enough money for each of those things.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's a very, yeah, simple concept. Yeah. It's just, you know, taking the time to set those up. Yeah. It literally took me maybe a week, you know, from going to the bank and setting up the accounts and kind of figuring out what my numbers were and all that stuff. And then once I started putting that in, this last year when we paid taxes, like I had a lot of extra money in that account. So just going from a place before where you had some tax issues to now a place where you got extra money and you pay your taxes and you still got money left, you're like, what am I going to do with this money now, right? Time to go.
Vacation.
Yeah, vacation or something. Now I earned my vacation, right? Yeah. Or I earned, you know, whatever that toy you're trying to buy, right?
Yeah.
So I think we hit it, man. I appreciate you coming out. I think there's a lot of takeaways. Where can people find you at? How do they get in touch with you?
Thetaxproblem.com on my website. I have all my contact info's on there.
Yeah.
And then my Instagram, I'm new at that. So, but it's Juan Montes, JDEA, uh-huh, is the handle. And then, you know, on Facebook, the business page is literally The Tax Problem.
Yeah.
So facebook.com/thetaxproblem, and that takes you to my page, which also has all our info. And, you know, follow that page. I'm always posting all kinds of articles on things that are relevant to, like, actually make an impact, you know.
Yeah.
So that I'm keeping people informed on all these new changes and, you know, crazy things like the new rules for independent contractors.
Yeah.
You know, look at that page. You'll see. I try to make sure that none of the posts are for lack of a better term, garbage.
Yeah.
So I try to just put good stuff up there, and I think people like it. So
that's good. Guys, for those of you listening, if you have a tax problem, you got to go to the tax problem guy right here.
Thank you.
I appreciate it, brother. Thank you.
Thanks for having me.
All right.